Okay, I'd like to thank everyone for being here at this lecture. It's one of my favorite works. It's actually probably my favorite book in history. It's On the Concept of History by Walter Benjamin. You can find it at marxist.org. I read it probably every 2 months. I make sure to read it. And basically, I think it's one of the most important works of Marxist philosophy. So if you want, there's actually a lecture on the value of philosophy that I put up. So I don't think everyone needs to read it. I don't think it's, you know, preferable. I think it's more important to build struggle than it is to study philosophy. But if you do are interested in Marxist philosophy, this is the one I would recommend to read. So I'm going to talk a little bit about Walter Benjamin, sort of where he's writing, what he's writing about. And then I'm going to talk about the work itself, which I think is actually very vital for understanding our struggles, only philosophically. Again, you can lead struggle without philosophy. It's just it's helpful in some very particular ways. Again, I'm not as prepared for this lecture as I'd like to be. Please ask if you have any questions. We're recording this for the people back home. So if you have a question, probably somebody else has a question. So that being said, if there are no questions to begin with, let's talk a little bit about Walter Benjamin and sort of where he's writing. So Walter Benjamin is a Marxist, Marxist philosopher, who is engaged in some of the most important debates of the time. Not all Marxist debates, but many Marxist debates, some that haven't even been resolved today, focus around Hegel, especially in philosophy. And so who is Hegel? Hegel is a German idealist who is a philosopher of dialectics and a philosopher of history. So Hegel is responding to Immanuel Kant, who was an Enlightenment philosopher, who wrote about human consciousness. And for Kant, there are certain structures of human consciousness that just everybody has. They're universal reason. And this universal reason is something innate to humanity, and it just structures everything we do, whether it's aesthetics, epistemology, that is how we know what we know, ethics, you know, the categorical imperative, et cetera, et cetera. But he says there's these universal, unchanging structures that every human being has. Well, Hegel is sort of building off of that, and Hegel lived at the time of the French Revolution, and his philosophy was infused with a new concept. And the concept that Hegel had was not only the dialectic, which goes back at least to Plato, if not earlier, but also the concept of history, that there was a progress to human consciousness. And the term that was used is it was teleological. And what do we mean by teleological? We mean that it had a direction, it had an endpoint, and that endpoint was absolute spirit or absolute mind, which was the culmination of all understandings before. So for Hegel, we started off a little better than primates. You know, we just had like sensory inputs of colors, and then the colors became shapes, and the shapes became objects, and then the objects became other people. You've probably heard of the master-slave dialectic of, you know, two people meet each other and they fight to the death for recognition, and one becomes a submits and becomes a slave, the other becomes a master. This turns into the work of the slave becomes labor, labor becomes society, society becomes religion, religion becomes science in a very particular sense for Hegel, and then science is absolute knowing. And so there's this process from us not really understanding anything where we dialectically progress to this period of absolute understanding, which he means by self-reflexivity. So what do we mean by self-reflexivity? Well, we're not only conscious of our ideas, but we can have ideas about ideas. We can not only be conscious about what we're doing or how we're doing it, we can become conscious of the very fact that we are doing things, right? So a sort of second level, second order consciousness. So Hegel is kind of like the main man for a while, and then along comes a political figure and a philosopher, and I think it's important to make that distinction. Maybe you've heard of him, kind of an obscure figure. Karl Marx comes along, right? And Karl Marx says, wait. So we have this Hegelian dialectic of ideas, but these ideas don't actually impact reality, right? We're only absolutely free in our ideas. And so Marx begins, the foundations of, with others, but a foundation of a new political economy, a new philosophy, a new politics, a new sociology, anthropology, et cetera, which starts talking about the idea, the concept, that ideas do not arise out of our heads, they arise out of the very world that we find ourselves in. They arise from the social relations, as the brother talked about last week, where it's not as things appear to us as objects. We go to the coffee shop and buy a cup of coffee, we go to our work and we either, you know, grade papers or lift boxes or, you know, sell people cups of coffee or grade papers. It's a shame that occurred twice. You can tell, mea culpa, that I come from an academic background. And this is the reality of the dialectic. And Marx said that this dialectic is based in the social relations. And he also said that there was a sort. People will say Marx had a strong teleology. I would rather say he had a very weak teleology, which is to say, people always characterize Marx as very strongly saying, nope, it starts in primitive society and then feudalism and then capitalism and then socialism and then, communism, whether you want to make that distinction or not. And that's just the way of human history, which I don't think is accurate. And Marx says this in the Communist Manifesto, right, that all societies have either ended in the victory for the lower class or mutual ruination of them both. And that's going to be very important when we talk about Benjamin, is that we don't have a strong teleology, a strong direction to history. And so this concept of a material rather than idealistic, and by material I mean the concrete reality around us, and social relations, right? The reason a cop can shoot you if you're an unarmed black man is not because there's something inherent about it, right? But there's a social reality and materiality to those kinds of relations. And so people begin to take this up. And Benjamin will, and we'll get to this, Benjamin actually believes that there's too much Hegelianism among many of the Marxists. Benjamin believes there's too much of a teleology that believes that, oh yes, the famous term is the dustbin of history, right? That we're just gonna progress and throw things into the dustbin of history. So this philosophy of materiality has two core components. That's dialectical and historical materialism. So when we're talking about dialectical materialism, what we're talking about is a philosophical concept that there is an interaction between our consciousness and the materiality of the world. That we make our own history, but we don't make the history in any old way. The weight of the past weighs upon us, on our brains like a nightmare, is what Marx famously said. And so it's this philosophy that wants to explain the interactions of complex systems, not as simple causality, A causes B causes C causes D, but rather the complex social relations that create the sort of world we find ourselves in and the world that we live in. Well, how does it do this? Well, it does it through historical materialism. It comes not from our ideas about ideas of history, but in fact what happened in history. For revolutionaries, I'm sure you've met the libertarian who will tell you how property arose, that Mr. Smith makes goats and Mr. James or John has wheat, and they enter a free agreement and exchange, and therefore they both satisfy each other's blah, 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 blah. Or even to talk about revolutionary history, the Soviet Union, they believed in a command economy, and so they centralized everything and forced everyone to do things in particular ways. which is certainly an interesting and I dare say plausible story, but it doesn't actually comport with the effects or what really happened, right? It wasn't that Mr. Smith and Mr. John decided to exchange things, right? Capitalism was formed with fire and the sword, you know, extracting resources from Africa and Latin America, kicking peasants off their land in England, right? And that's the reality. You know, you can make up stories about why the Soviet Union did X, Y, and Z, but to actually know the historical materialist basis, you have to know how the party functioned, what the conditions were, what the international conditions were, how the hierarchy or lack of hierarchy of the party led to whatever. So again, the point is, it's not about having a plausible story about things. It's about, in fact, knowing what really happened. And this will be very important when we talk about history as the history of the victor. Historical materialism is not, should not be, although again, this is Benjamin's critique, it should not be the history of the victor. And we'll talk a little bit about that. So what politically was happening in Benjamin's time? He's writing in the 20s, in the 30s, a little event known as World War I happened, right? And after roughly when Marx died, Engels was still around. They created the Second Internationale. So the First Internationale was primarily Marxist, socialist, anarchist. There was a split between them. For various reasons, it collapsed. So they created a Second Internationale based primarily around Marxist parties, or in name, Marxist parties. And basically, these people were awful. Not universally, there were good points and bad points, but they basically became, to kind of use American phraseology, they became sort of the greens of the political spectrum, right? And they were always, you know, like they became labor parties and social democratic parties. When push came to shove, almost without exception, all of them voted to go to war in World War I, right? So where's the international working solidarity if you're voting for your country to slaughter other workers by the millions for the sake of colonies, right? So this absolutely disintegrates the Second Internationale. And the core of the Second Internationale was social democracy. We quickly enter the Third Internationale under Lenin and the Comintern, the Communist International, and a new political ideology, Marxism-Leninism, or the Jewish Bolshevik threat to world, blah, blah, blah. But it had a fundamentally different character. Benjamin would probably say not enough of a different character, but we'll get into that in his sort of critique of history. There was a universal disintegration of international solidarity through World War I, which was then slowly reestablished around the Soviet Union. So what was the primary ideology? That was social democracy. And it's important to note that what we mean by social democracy today is by and large what they meant by social democracy then. We're for the workers. Right, social democracy, oh yes, we have political democracy, but what we mean by, you know, we need more democracy, we need social democracy, which primarily they meant economically. And these social democrats basically were like, yeah, we need better wages for workers, less working hours, et cetera, et cetera. Oh, we shouldn't oppress our colonies so much, et cetera, et cetera. But essentially, you know, it's important to remember that who forced the austerity on Greece, you know, in the last 10 years? Who forced the austerity on Spain in the last few years? Well, those were the socialist parties. And they're still members of the Second International. It's still around. It's not in too happening shape. But, right, like these guys became the agents of oppression. There were other social democrats, like the Russian Social Democratic Party of Labor, who had obscure figures like Vladimir Ilyich Lenin, right? Who reacted and denounced this form of social democracy. It also included people in Germany, like Rosa Luxemburg, who denounced the war and were willing to rise up with the workers and were ultimately crushed by the Social Democrats, ostensibly our friends on the left. So this is the context in which he's writing. The disintegration of the international working movement, the repudiation and utter failure of social democracy, and basically a wide open field. And just as a personal note, this is why I think it's so important, at least for me, to read this, is after the disintegration of the Soviet Union, we are now facing questions on how do we move forward, right? Some people say, we need to refound the left. Marxism, Leninism is a failure. We need to come up with something new. Other people are saying, oh, well, you know, we need to have a fusion of different ideologies. We need to come up, you know, with much respect to the Bolivarian Revolution, right? We need 21st century socialism. And I think we actually get a clear sign from Benjamin that that's probably not the direction we need to go. And I'll talk about that as our connection to the past. So this is where Benjamin is writing. Are there any questions, comments, additions, kind of dealing with this issue? Please.
Are we going to expand on historical materialism, at least from Benjamin's point of view, right?
Yes, absolutely. And it's arguable that this was the primary thing he wrote about. And so we'll kind of talk, I'll talk a little bit about the Arcades Project as part of combating history as history of the victor. But yes, that's our core. But are there any other questions or comments, observations about this? Okay. So we'll move on. So Benjamin is going roughly, and it's a very short work, I would recommend you read it, to address history as après coup, history as a history of the victor, history as a dialectical connection to the present, and the redemption. And this will factor very heavily in to what Benjamin is talking about. So what does après coup mean? Yes, I know it's a jargonistic, Lacanian, psychoanalytic phrase, but it actually conveys the idea very clearly of what history means. And in roughly translated, it's a delayed action. So that the past only happens retroactively, but was always already what was going to happen. So that sounds weird as hell. What does that mean? The easiest example I can use would be, and it fits very well with Benjamin, the Messiah, right? And of course, the Messiah means a war leader, etc. He talks about this in Divine Violence, on a Critique of Violence, which is again another work. He talks about divine violence as ending the law, and it's clear that he's talking about a Christological figure as the Messiah. So think about this, and again, this is the clearest example I've been able to give to people besides throwing accretes at them, and generally I try to avoid throwing 260 pages books and be like, there, you understand it now. Think about, again, I would imagine not too many people here are religious, but think about Jesus as the Christ, right? So what's the basic narrative? Well, we have Adam and Eve, they're chilling all naked-like, and then they eat the apple, and then they're sinful, right? And they're unable to be saved, right, because they've sinned. And so depending on your denomination, they go to hell, they go to purgatory, some sort of prison, awful place. But the thing is, if that is the narrative, right, then it doesn't really make any sense, right? And then suddenly this dude, this Palestinian in Nazareth shows up and says, no, man, that's not what's happening. It's part of a plan. And, you know, part of this is also the Catholic Church, so don't get too theological about this particular aspect. But he's like, no, I'm going to die and I'm going to redeem all the sins from the past, right? But in that conception, then Adam and Eve, while they're biting the apple and condemning us all to sin, have already, like, Jesus Christ is already, après coup, always already coming to redeem their sins, right? So these events in the past do not happen as just in the past, but the very meaning of it becomes new given our present situation, right? It's kind of a weird concept, but roughly, do you kind of get what we're talking about with that? Okay, so So what the hell does this have to do with, historical and dialectical materialism? Well, this is how Benjamin opens on the concept of history. And this is the first thesis, so keep this in mind. It is well known that an automaton once existed, which was so constructed that it could counter any move of a chess player with a counter move, and thereby assured itself of victory in the match. A puppet in Turkish attire, water pipe in mouth, sat before the chessboard, which rested on a broad table. Through a system of mirrors, the illusion was created that the table was transparent from all sides. In truth, a hunchback dwarf who was a master chess player sat inside, controlling the hands of the puppet with strings. One can envision a corresponding object to this apparatus in philosophy. The puppet is called historical materialism. It is always supposed to win. It can do this with no further ado against any opponent, so long as it employs the service of theology, which everyone knows is small and ugly and must be kept out of sight. So this is where we start to get both history as but also history as the history of the victor, right? Historical materialism built itself among many Marxists as an ideology that would always end in victory. But there was a problem with this, which is theology, right, in the strong Hegelian sense, had to be there, right? Suddenly, the redemption didn't come from absolute knowing or science. Redemption did not come from the return of Jesus. Redemption did not come, from technology or progress. Technology, or the dwarf that would save us all was the workers. And they would save us because they were destined by the very structure of history to lead us to victory, right? And how often have we heard this critique of Marxists and communists and, blah, blah, blah. And so this theology was always a history of the victor. It's just now we've decided that there will be a new victor. Well, okay, that's great, but then what of the past? And what Benjamin says about the past is he points out this weird contradiction. It's funny because I could just stand up here and give an exegesis because everything's so great. So here's our relation to the past, which kind of gets into history is the dialectical connection to the present. Actually, it's probably best if I just go through all of these because they're all interconnected. So history is history of the victor. And again, I'm sorry, I should have been better organized to this. This is the embodiment of the great man of history thesis. This is the embodiment of manifest destiny. This is the embodiment of the end of history that we're living in, which is to say, all history exists under most conceptions to be a history of the victor, right? Why is the United States ascendant? Well, the United States is ascendant because it is the victor of history. Why were there Africans here? What is their history? What were American Indians' history? What was Latin America's history? It's a history that exists only to explain and justify, however sad and however tragic it is, the ascendancy of the United States, right? Why, just crack any high school textbook, and even when they make plays at multiculturalism, it's very clear why these people existed. They existed so Thomas Jefferson could write his wonderful words. They existed so these great founding fathers could discuss X, Y, and Z, and then they only exist as an unrecognized substratum, an unrecognized history that, again, only exists for the victor. The next is history has a dialectical connection to the past. So as with the apparatu, right? Just like with Jesus retroactively making the past meaningful, we also live in a present that history is always intervening, and the meaning of it is always in question. It's always something to be struggled for. In 1926, right, the brutality, if we have a history of the victor, but are still communists, right, still attempting to do dialectical and historical materialism, the mass murder of millions of people through World War I, the mass colonization and exploitation of the Third World, that, you know, that in retrospect became a new history under the Soviet Union. The very present existence of the Soviet Union in 1926, and especially in 1930, while they were arming, you know, revolutionary movements across the world, in 1960, 1970, where they were supplying arms to Vietnam and Africa and Latin America, suddenly the suffering, the historical suffering of those people was dialectically interpreted not simply as a history of European colonization, which was the only history pushed, right, the history of the victor hitherto, but suddenly the very present, right, of arms shipments going to Cuba, arms shipments going to Vietnam, arms shipments going to Africa, altered that history of colonization, and it changed it in the present, right, from a history of oppression and imperialism and the dominance and white supremacy of Europe to a longer history of oppressed people struggling for their freedom, right? And so the very material conditions that existed generated our connection to the past. So for us today, we need to ask about our dialectical connection to the past, which means we have to understand, for those of us who call ourselves communists, not simply that, oh, yes, there was capitalist restoration in the Soviet Union, or, oh, you know, the Soviet Union was state capital or whatever, but rather we have to understand what the collapse of the Soviet Union means to us in our very present. So this isn't just an abstract question, but permeates our very existence. The rise of neoliberalism, the privatization of social institutions, you know, the ascendancy of imperialism around the world, and people's movements taking on a new character like the Bolivarian Revolution. But all of this intrudes, right? If the Soviet Union were still around today, the history of the Soviet Union would mean something fundamentally different to us, right? And so Benjamin's point is not you know, that, oh, history is progressing to the future, but rather history is intruding in the present and permeates the very life world that we exist in. And then this is Benjamin's ultimate project, which is the redemption. And this is very important. For Benjamin, unlike for most Marxists, the redemption is not a utopian future. Rather, it is a justification and avenging of the past. That, and well, I'll get into a direct quote, but this is fundamentally different than how many Marxists characterize themselves, right? Many Marxists are, we're building a gloriously bright future, which again, there's nothing wrong with that. But for Benjamin, what he says is that ignores the history that actually exists and permeates our world. And he even sees great danger in that. So let's talk a little bit about his conception of the past and how it intrudes. And he was writing in the 30s, so this is a little bit sexist, but it helps elucidate the point. Not that that's a justification, I'm just letting you know beforehand. So one of the key things to keep in mind, raise your hand if you envy the future. Who here envies the people who have not yet been born? Okay, I see some like sheepish hands, because I do all the time. I think about it all the time, how much I envy the future. But that's weird, right? It's weird that I envy people who don't yet exist, right? Like, who does that? People who read Benjamin, obviously. But what does he say about this, right? Why don't we have this envy of the future? He says, the happiness which could awaken envy in us exists only in the air we have breathed. The people we could have spoken with, the people we might have been able to get, might be able to have given themselves to us. The conception of happiness, in other words, resonates irredeemably without that resurrection. And it says transfiguration or redemption. It is that same concept of the past which makes history into its affair. The past carries a secret index with it by which it refers to its resurrection. Are we not touched by the same breath of air which was among that which came before? Is there not an echo of those who have been silenced in the voices which we lend our ears today? Have not people we court, brothers and sisters, who they do not recognize anymore? If so, that there is a secret protocol or appointment between the generations of the past and that of our own. For we have been expected upon this earth, for it has been given us to know, just like every generation before us, a weak Masonic power on which the past has a claim. So that's very important. The past has, or we all have a weak Masonic power on which the past has its claim. This claim is not settled lightly, and the historical materialist knows why. So we're dealing with a bunch of different things that are happening. First is history as après coup, right? History intrudes upon us because, we could imagine having the flying car and whatnot, right? But here's a good example. I'm going to just go with it. Sexual relationships, right? Everything we do, whether you're, asexual, pansexual, polyamorous, monogamous, etc., is conditioned by the very background history of the oppression of women and sexual minorities, right? We don't live in a world in which, people have been free, enlightened, equal people, and those of us in Utah know that very well, given, the oppression that women face here, especially with, ordained women. And so we're conditioned by that very thing. The thing that, for example, people asking for sexual liberation want is equality, right? They want to be free of discrimination just as others have been in the past, particularly cisgendered white men, right? But this is the thing, is we don't have a conception of a future in which we have put an end to that oppression, right? Even very progressive socialist states like Cuba, where gender reassignment surgery is covered, right? They still have that history of, being a Catholic country, right? And so we all live in this history of oppression. We don't live in the we couldn't live in an imaginary future where these social relations didn't exist. Does that make sense to people? But then here's the problem. It's a problem for us, and it's been a problem for every single generation. Is all of those people, right, who have been oppressed, right, and we just had Pride a couple weeks ago, right, where does Pride come from? It comes from the Stonewall riots, or rebellion, more accurately, where, gay, lesbian, and transgendered people were being oppressed by the police and fought back. Every generation since, those people who fought back have a weak messianic claim, right? A claim for a Messiah from our generation to fulfill the promise of equality that they have been denied, right? As does the next generation, right? In the promise of Nat Turner and Lavoie Toussaint and Harriet Tubman and Hugo Chavez and Che Guevara and Pancho Villa, even people who we would consider successful, Ho Chi Minh, Lenin, Rosa Luxemburg, the fact that we have not achieved right, the liberation that they fought and in many cases died for exercises a Masonic power that we, that history is dialectically connected to us in our demand for that justice. Not an abstract future ideal utopia, but as a redemption of the suffering in the past and the oppression in the past. Where does he say this most clearly? And he actually, And he's talking about his very political life, right? We were talking about social democracy. He points out the dangers of having this teleological future of we'll arrive at a time of full communism where everybody's happy and everybody works however they want, et cetera, et cetera. So Nietzsche, he opens with a quote from Nietzsche. We need history, but we need it differently than the spoiled, lazy bones in the Garden of Knowledge. So with that in mind, he says, the subject of historical cognition is the battling oppressed class itself. So it's the literal subject of history, right? Now, this is fundamentally different from saying it's the workers as like a new absolute God that will bring us into the glorious future. It's the oppressed subject. In Marx, it steps forward as the final enslaved and avenging class, which carries out the work of emancipation in the name of generations of downtrodden to its conclusion. Again, notice what he says about Marx. Marx is not saying that there will be a glorious future that the proletariat will usher in. What does Marx say? By having nothing left to lose but their chains, they will avenge the entire history of oppression. This consciousness, for which in the short term made itself felt in the Spartacus, and he's talking about the Spartacus splinter group, the forerunner of the German Communist Party, Rosa Luxemburg, and the workers rose up and were brutally murdered by the social democratic government of the Weimar Republic. But he's saying they knew, right, the very act in naming themselves, the Spartacus League. They were recognizing this oppressed past. And of course, Lenin constantly referred to the Bolsheviks, right, as proletarian Jacobins, right? So for these revolutionaries who are leading revolution, there's this intimate connection to the past. This consciousness, which for a short time made itself felt in the Spartacus, was objectionable to social democracy from the very beginning. In the course of 3 decades, it succeeded in almost completely erasing the name of Blanqui, whose distant thunder had made the preceding century tremble. And Blanqui was a pre-Marxist communist who led uprising after uprising, spent most of his life in jail. So social democracy, it contented itself with the assigning of the working class the role of the savior of future generations. It thereby severed the sinews of its greatest power. Through this schooling, the class, working class, forgot its hate as much as its spirit of sacrifice. For both nourished themselves on the picture of enslaved forebears and not the ideal emancipated heirs, like hares with an H. So what do we see here? And this is my favorite passage, right, is it's not just abstract, right? If you are selling people a glorious future with, hey, you know, you can only work 4 hours and everybody can have a PlayStation 3, or I guess it's PlayStation 4 now. And yeah, it'll be great, and you can smoke a bunch of weed and have a lot of sex because there won't be bourgeois morality. Maybe some people will be interested in that, right? But that's not how we build a movement. We build a movement by reminding people of their grandfathers, like my great-grandfather, who worked in a mine down in Eureka and had a cave-in that severed his nose from his face and had to be reattached, right? We remind ourselves of our forefathers and, to use the term, foremothers, right, who were arrested and beaten and raped for suffrage, right? we avenge ourselves not in this idealist bourgeois or idealist proletarian sexual utopia where everyone can do whatever they want. We remind ourselves of high school students who are harassed and beaten and are not able to have a GSA on campus, right? And again, all that came before, right? And so that's our greatest strength, not the redemption of the future that is imaginary, but standing in direct connection and history to the past. That our struggle is not the struggle for the future, but the struggle of the avenging stroke of all the oppressed, right? Any questions, comments, thoughts on this so far? Okay. So what are we combating, right? Certainly, he would not say we are, he would not deny we are combating the usual forms of oppression, factory work, workers, unsafe working conditions, oppression of women, oppression of national minorities, or oppressed nations themselves that are a nation in an empire and, you know, are unfree. But also we're combating the history of the oppressor. Right, and in fact, you'll notice it was only really in the 60s and 70s, right, where national liberation became a struggle, that they included a branch of history. So I'm not by any means, I don't think any of the people who did post-colonial studies, I mean, maybe they read Benjamin or not, and I'm not trying to in any way give credit to him for these things, right? But he's talking about, before it was conceived, a subaltern history. Right, the hidden history of the oppressed. In the United States, it's the hidden history of the African nation that is in, you know, in the American empire. It is the history of the Chicano nation that is hidden in the empire. It is the history of women, LGBTQ people, American Indians, etc., that is hidden in the empire, to which they were only passive objects for the victor. Right, for the white American male, so that he, in a general sense, could have his great destiny of world conquest. And so that's, you know, where we gain our strength, right? And notice that that entire field of history and study arose out of people looking to their identity, to their past, to their culture, as part of their immediate material struggles, right? This is why people know who Zapata is, right? And he's such a central figure to the Chicano nation and Pancho Villa. And this is why if you go down to, you know, Rose Park or Midvale, where I grew up, you can always see the lowrider t-shirts, right? That in the back have Cuauhtémoc, right? And Aztec pyramids, right? Because it's that intimate connection, not necessarily even to an ideal civilization, but to the oppression that we've faced. So there's the material oppression, but then what is the historical oppression? Well, he talks about why it's so important and why we must be aware of this. It's not, what's at stake is not simply, oh, do people look at the future or at the past? It's much deeper for him. To articulate what the past does not recognize, quote unquote, how it really was, To articulate what is past does not mean to recognize how it really was, right? And you get this among history majors. Oh, we just need to learn more data and then we'll know how it really was. He doesn't believe that that's what history really is. It means to take control of a memory as it flashes in a moment of danger. For historical materialism, it is the question of holding fast to a picture of the past, just as if it had unexpectedly thrust itself in a moment of danger on the historical subject. The danger threatens the stock of tradition as much as its recipients. For both, it is one and the same thing, handing itself over as the tool of the ruling class. In every epoch, the attempt must be made to deliver traditions anew from the conformism which is on the point of overwhelming it. For the Messiah arrives not merely as a redeemer, but it also arrives as the vanquisher of the Antichrist. The only writer of history with a gift for setting alight the spark of hope in the past is the one who conceives of this, and this is what Benjamin is really fighting, that not even the dead will be safe from the enemy if he is victorious, and the enemy has not ceased to be victorious, right? Again, look at the 1960s, right? The Black Panthers and the Pan-Africanist movement, right? And, the Brown Berets and the Young Lords, right? They took up the struggle of the past. This is where, for example, cultural studies arose. And won't you notice that now that the enemy has not ceased to be victorious, what is the thing that they're beginning to cut in places like Arizona, Texas, New Mexico, California, Utah, the very cultural studies that link people to their past. So again, it's about combating the history of the victor. And again, we see this constantly, Marx talks about this in the 18th of Brumaire, is the revolutionary struggle always dresses itself in the clothes of the past. The French Revolution saw themselves as Roman Republicans and referred to themselves as such. The Communards viewed themselves as Red Jacobins, as did Lenin, right? With some qualification, the Maoists under Mao viewed themselves as Chinese Bolsheviks, right? And so for us today, the point is not to find some new magic ideology, but rather, and this is somewhat self-serving of me, right, to see ourselves, right, as the Maoists today, right? And you can see this in the Indian Maoists, the Naxalites, the Nepali Maoists, right? There is a historical connection there, but what they're doing now is something fundamentally different, but they're linking themselves to that very struggle, just as we should link ourselves to the Bolsheviks, just as we should link ourselves to the Internationale, just as we should link ourselves to the French Revolution, just as we should link ourselves to Nat Turner and La Voix Toussaint and the Black Panthers and Spartacus, right, as the historical connection that sustains us. And so it's this sort of redemption that we're looking for. And what would that sort of redemption look like? We'll talk about the new angel. And this is a real picture. I'd recommend his friend, Paul Klee, I believe, actually painted it for him. But he says, so he opens with Gerhard Scholem, angelic greeting. My wing is ready to fly. I would rather turn back, for had I stayed, mortal time would have had little luck. There is a painting by Klee called Angelus Novus, a new angel. An angel is depicted there who looks as though he were about to distance himself from something which he is staring at. His eyes are open, his mouth stands open, and his wings are outstretched. The angel of history must look just so. His face is turned towards the past, where we see the appearance of a chain of events, so causality. He sees one catastrophe, which unceasingly piles rubble on top of rubble and hurls it before his feet. He would like to pause for a moment, so fair, to awaken the dead and to piece together what has been smashed. But the storm is blowing from paradise. It has caught itself up in his wings and is so strong that the angel can no longer close them. The storm drives him irresistibly into the future to which his back is turned, while the rubble heap before him grows sky high. That which we call progress is this storm. Right? So again, it's anti-Hegelian. It's anti-teleological. And Zizek makes this implicit point, right, is that if only the angel could flap its wings, right, if only it could stop the catastrophe that is known as progress, if it could stop this catastrophe of Hegelian teleological progress, right, which in the world today goes by the name of economic development, right? We're always developing. The world is always developing. The third world is always developing. And what is it? It's a catastrophe that piles rubble after rubble. And who are the dead? Well, they're poor Indian peasants who now have to use Monsanto grain that they can't sustain themselves, right? It's people literally enslaved in Africa to mine rare earth minerals so that we can have cell phones and computers. And so, again, what is required is not a new teleology of the working class, right, but rather that we put an end to the notion of teleological progress. Again, very philosophical and very abstract, but think about the concrete ways it can be instituted. Cuba, right, is a socialist nation, and they were part of the Soviet teleology of progress, right? Khrushchev said, "We will bury you." And what did he mean? Americans took it wrongly, and clearly they intended to take it wrongly, of "we will bury you," that we're going to kill y'all with some nukes, right? Because that served their interests so they could militarize. But what he really meant is we will outproduce you in everything, in science, technology, consumer goods, everything, right? But in this, we find the old teleology of progress, right? And Cuba was part of this, right? They had massive oil-based plantations that made sugar that they sent out and brought in the newest goods from the Soviet Union. But now progress stopped with the collapse of the Soviet Union, right? Progress in this very socialist progress in this very particular sense. And they entered the special period, right? They entered a moment of crisis, a moment of danger. And so what saved them? Well, socialism is the broad answer, right? But also instituting a new society divorced from progress as teleology, an institution of community organizing, community politics, and community economy, such that now Cuba, right, is almost universally organic, right? And there's food grown everywhere, right? And it's community associations that bear no resemblance, right, to the capitalist and imperialist mind of progress. I remember seeing something ridiculous that Cubans now have less than 1% of the economic wealth they had in the 1950s. Like, I can't remember what right-wing think tank put this out, right? But in the 1950s, right, they had a dictator and the people would starve to death everywhere and were homeless and had to work for wages that they couldn't, you know, help themselves. But somehow they're 100 times worse off, that there are no starving people in Cuba. There are, you know, sick people in Cuba get better care than we get here. And there are no homeless people. And yet it's a sociological fact that just 70 miles north in the richest empire in the history of the world, there are hungry, starving, homeless people, right? And so we need to recognize that we need a new conception of history that is not teleological in this sense, right? Now, what is that? Benjamin doesn't tell us, right? Because it's based out of the history that we're living in. And as we progress, we will find new connections to the past and must find new connections to the past rather than infinitely trying to guess at a new future, right? That's what you hear like from Occupy, right? What was Occupy's thing? Oh, we're a new movement, like no other movement that has existed before. Or the Arab Spring, it's something new that's never existed before. Well, this very newness of the movement that had everyone so excited was also the very thing that disconnected itself from the roots, right, of all the struggles that came before. So here's the final passage in Benjamin. "In relation to the history of organic life on Earth," notes a recent biologist, "the miserable 50 millennia of Homo sapiens represents something like 2 seconds of the 24-hour day. The entire history of civilized humanity would, on this scale, take up only 1/5 of the last second of the last hour. The here and now, which as the model of messianic times summarizes the entire history of humanity, is a monstrous abbreviation. It coincides to a hair with the figure which the history of humanity makes in the universe," right? And the final idea, right, that he's leaving is everyone wants to focus on the present. Everyone wants to focus on the here and now, the immediate struggle, as something new, right? But unfortunately, it shows a lack of perspective of what's really happening. Obviously, the point is not that humans don't matter and, you know, the usual, oh, but the universe is 8 billion years old, so what does it matter? And or the annoying Facebook meme that's going around like, oh, humans have only existed for blah, 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 and we're destroying the Earth, right? But the point that he's trying to make is history has been disconnected, and not simply disconnected in some abstract way, it's been stolen. And we need to reclaim that history of the struggle, not simply to the great proletarian cultural revolution, not simply to this, you know, China stands up against Japanese imperialism, not just to the grandma, right, and the 18 survivors who went to the Sierra Maestra mountains, but, you know, to the Soviets in Petrograd, to the Jacobins, right, and the Committee of Public Safety, to the peasant rebellions in not simply England and France, but also, you know, the Mexica uprisings, the Comanche, Apache uprisings, the slave rebellions, and even further, and recognize that we need to conceptualize our history as an ongoing, not historical project, right, projected into the future, but rather as a retroactive struggle to avenge all of the oppression by defeating the oppressor. And who is that oppressor, right? It is the system of capitalism and exploitation that is always already present in class society and is always destroying, you know, all of us, right? We should recognize that we're being ground under its heel from, right, the millions that died in the Potosí mining silver, to those who were pillaged in the Hundred Years' War in Germany, right? And that needs to become a new history above and beyond the history of the victor. And so, anyway, that's kind of what I've got. Benjamin's really, really difficult and interesting, and I could probably spend, I don't know, let's see, what's the douchiest way to say this? I could probably do a year-long graduate seminar on this text alone. But I really encourage people to read it. It's a very short read. But yeah, so that's what I've got. Do you have any questions, comments, fiery denunciations, clarifications, additions? Okay.